Hello there. I don't know if you can hear me, but I'd like to remind you star 7 to unmute.
Can you guys hear us now? Kyle, you'll need to hit star 7 to unmute your line.
Yep, I'm on.
Oh, great. Awesome. So, yeah. So Kyle's item is under line 94 in the Etherpad. You can click on the link there to watch his demo. So Kyle, we've got your screen up in front of us. What are we looking at?
Sure. So thank you for having me on this morning, and good morning to everyone. Once again, my name is Kyle Bowen. I'm the Director of Informatics here at Purdue University. Really warm and fuzzy guy, so if you have any questions today, please feel free to share those at any time. We're going to talk a little bit about Passport, a new technology we developed here at Purdue, as a way to help our instructors begin to bridge between traditional learning, classroom learning, and using badges as ways to recognize smaller units of learning. We're also implementing it in a number of different courses. We have our online courses that are largely focused on nanotechnology and other similar topics, in addition to non-traditional learning opportunities. So these would be student organizations or the orientation programs, student success programs, these kinds of things, in addition to the student government and other types of student-run organizations. So with that, should I just go ahead and launch into a demonstration? Would that make sense?
Yeah, let's do it.
Absolutely. So what we're looking at here, this is what we call our studio page. So the studio is a collection of projects that we execute on a number of different topics, and each one begins to re-envision some aspect of the learning experience, whether it be the classroom experience or textbooks or assignments. And so with Passport, what we wanted to re-envision is what is a grade, and what should it mean, and what could it mean if we actually gave it a little bit more information. So if you'd like to read more or see more about Studio or any of our other projects or Passport, just purdue.edu/studio. You can kind of take a look there. There's also a place there where you can apply for a beta account. So we're testing this with a limited number of instructors this semester to see what are the different options for implementing badges inside of the classroom. So there's an application there. It's really short, just kind of your name, email, and what you're thinking about doing. And so feel free to submit your application there. So I'm going to just kind of launch right into Passport. I've already authenticated, but at this point you can. So getting into Passport is you can log in with your Facebook or Google credentials, or you can optionally create a Passport account. So all that really requires is an email address. Anyone can create an account and log in. There's a one group in here that has two challenges in it, which are getting started with Passport. And so there's the Passport Cadet and the Passport Presenter. Both of these are challenges that help describe what Passport does, what role it fills, and it uses the tool as a way to explore that. And then Presenter gets into, okay, now that I've acquired some of these badges, then what do I actually do with them? And that's where we go into explain a little further about how you can share them or publish them to your backpack and other places that you can present your badges. So feel free at any time. You can launch right into create your account with Passport or log in with your credentials and access those badges. But from an instructor standpoint, really the goal here was to try and ease the transition to a different form of learning. So when we begin to engage with our faculty, they tend to fall into one of two groups. They tend to call into what we call the fives, or these are the faculty into virtually everything. So these are the faculty that are early adopters in every way. You can get them to do about anything. But the challenge there is that everyone knows that they're the early adopters. So there's a challenge in applying their credibility to other people. At the other end of the spectrum, we have what we call the faves, which is an acronym for faculty against virtually everything. And with them, it takes more of a convincing to get them to make a transition. But the value they provide is they bring to this skepticism about, well, is this really going to provide value to me? And that's really the source of our interest is how do we take these tools and help faculty be more successful, or help our students be more successful, but also enable our faculty to teach in new ways. So that's what I wanted to show you today is from a professor's or instructor's perspective, how do they actually create an issue, a badge as part of a challenge? And really that's what we wanted to do is have a tool that from end to end, so from idea all the way up to issuing the badge itself, it enables that for the instructor, so they really don't have to have any specific skills in order to do that. And it also helps manage part of that learning process. So the high-level organizational structure inside of Passport is with the group. And a group can be about anything, but a group is essentially a way to organize collections of badges. So for example, your course, so if you're taking, let's say, English 101, then your English 101 class would be the group that you belong to, and they would present you with a series of challenges related to English 101. In this case, I have my just sandbox group here where I can create anything I want to inside of that space. So as an instructor, what I'm going to do is create my first challenge. So I'll just say add challenge. I just give it a particular name, and I have a simple one. Survivor. Can't type today. And then with that, I can also provide a short description. And so these are all things that come along with the challenge itself. So a challenge is a collection of tasks that have to be completed in order to earn the badge itself. So badges and challenges are very much linked inside of Passport tool. With the description, I can provide text information. I can embed HTML or embed YouTube videos, these kinds of things. I'm just going to kind of pass over it for the sake of this demonstration. The next stage, after I've kind of established, okay, here's my challenge and what it's called, the next stage is I can actually create my badge. And so in this case, you can upload your badge art, understanding that most instructors don't have really the skills to make a solid-looking badge. We designed a badge maker so that an instructor can come in and create badges in a number of different shapes. Interestingly enough, it seems that the postage stamp shape seems to be the most popular thus far, slightly beating out the mustache badge. With that, we can begin to do things like mixing pieces and parts, so we can bring in patterns. We can also bring in an image into this. If I grab an image off my computer, then I can bring that in and begin to customize the badge in different ways. And then I can also give it icons, these kinds of things. So if I wanted to make a much more simple badge or apply some text to it, these types of things, then I have a number of options in terms of how I actually create my badge. And once I'm happy with it, I just say Create Badge. And now you can see up here in the corner, I got my new badge. And now I establish my tasks. So tasks are the things that need to be done in order to complete the challenge. And a challenge has as many tasks as need to be added. And those tasks take one of a couple of different forms. So when I click Add Task here, it asks me for my task name. Then I can provide some additional information. So this too can be, YouTube videos or we've seen a number of different kind of, let's call them hacks that people have done. So the different ways they've hacked, like their Tumblr accounts, they've done similar types of things here. And then the tasks take on one of these different forms. So it's either a file upload, sharing of a link, it's completing an assessment or a short quiz. And then the last one is a custom. And a custom is essentially where the instructor makes a manual check of whatever it is. Uploading a file is what it sounds like. So a task is, well, craft a document on this topic and submit it. Sharing a link is just the same thing, but it's a virtual online resource. Completing an assessment is where they create or craft an actual quiz that happens inside of the tool. And we also see instructors use this not so much in addition to assessment as a survey. So that's where there's not really a correct answer, but more just as a way to collect information. So we're seeing that actually with our online classes where we want the students, in order to get their badge, to finish just a short, five-question exit survey capturing the top components. And so we can begin to enable some of that data collection through an assessment mechanism. And then also on items like sharing a link, for example, we can enable making these shareable so that when I submit a link as part of my assignment, that then also gets shared out with the other students inside of the class. And then each item also has this option here, which is requiring a structural approval. So if we wanted to create a task that has, let's say, 5 steps to it, that each step along the way could require an instructor to come in and accept or approve that step before moving on. Or conversely, a challenge or every one of its tasks can be fully automated, meaning that as each task is being completed, the student's just automatically leveling up through the tool. If I save that there, and I will just say publish just to kind of move on here. But the last is the publishing set. Oh, I didn't actually save my task, did I? Anyways, the sharing the link, save. There we go. Task instructions are required. So clearly we need to improve our instructions a little better. There we go. And I can add as many tasks as I want to, and I can mix and match in terms of their types. So share a link here, share a document there, require approval at this step. What we're finding a lot of faculty like to do are say, okay, do these 5 tasks, and then there's one approval for all of the tasks. So they're really looking at the creation of a portfolio of work. So now once I have my challenge, I can just publish that out. Now inside of my sandbox, there's a new badge here that I can go and complete as a student, so I can just kind of drive into it. And in this case, it's just simply sharing a link. And then also as a student, I can submit comments back to that. So as these assets get collected over the course of doing a project, then they go to support the issuance of the badge itself. So once I have a set of badges, and this is dangerous because I don't know what badges I'm going to have in here. Okay, these are fairly benign.
Hey, Kyle.
Yeah.
I want to jump in because I think it's fair to say that our badges team in particular is losing their mind over your demo and has a host of questions. Which are taking shape under line 116. So I'm just wondering, can we move to Q&A?
Sure, one please, by all means. Would you mind relaying the questions to me?
Sure. So I've sneakily added my question to the top of the list, which is, will these badges account for university credit?
No.
Is there a plan or a possibility that they may at some point in the future?
There's a discussion around that.
Okay.
So what we're looking at, let me give you an example of a corollary situation. So for example, if in high school you took a number of foreign language classes, you can come here and take a test and test out of your foreign languages. So the idea is, could badges serve in a similar role?
Cool. So also questions around what's the badge creator based on? More concretely, is this an open source project, and is the code forkable?
So the badge creator itself we created, and the tool is not open source.
Okay.
What if people want to use it? What can they do?
So if people are excited by what you just demoed and want to draw from it or build on it, what can they do?
Submit the application for beta. So
okay.
A big part of what we're doing now is really related to the experimenting with the technology. And so Purdue as a state institution, one of our struggles becomes how do we support or how do we deliver technology like this to larger groups. And so in doing so, we typically look for partners to help us do that. So we have other technologies where we've partnered with the Gates Foundation, for example, in an effort to bring that technology around. So part of it's not so much an unwillingness to do it. It's just a matter of, well, it's very new, and we're really kind of experimenting with it. But at the same time, we have to figure out, you know, what is the mechanism that we use to bring this make this more widely available. We certainly want to. And our beta program is the first time we've done it with the technology, and it's working out fairly well because what we can do is begin to let people begin to experiment with it and report back ideas that then continue to enhance the tool in moving forward. But certainly we're you know, open to any conversations around that.
Cool. So yeah, I think there's more sort of sub-questions in detail. Maybe you can stick around and chat, Kyle, because I think there's folks that may have some ideas for you there. Just moving through the list of other questions, just been a few weeks since the start of school, but how has the response been from faculty and students so far?
Sure. The faculty response has been fantastic. That's where, you know, it's the most exciting part about it has been, you know, once we began to once the faculty saw what it was, everyone saw something different in it. So they saw some other different problem that they could solve in their class, whether it be related to online learning, whether it be related to their portfolio development. Our business school just announced yesterday that they have a new program around how to help our business students be more employable, and they're using Passport as a mechanism to deliver that. So that's where there's been a great response there. On the student side, it's a little different. It's been one of kind of optimism about it, but at the same time, you know, all of their friends don't have these. It's not something that's terribly popular. It wasn't something they were already thinking about. So a big part of it was, showing them the value of the badge, and once you in 30-second explanation of it, they instantly saw the value. It was clearly, oh, I have this thing. It's a collection of badges that's unique to me. It makes me more employable. It's something that no other student can have. You know, these kinds of ideas, and I can link to them from, you know, my LinkedIn profile or from my resume or something like that. So they really saw the value right. So it required a little bit of an explanation, but thus far it's like they instantly get it as soon as you give it a little bit of emphasis.
Great. There's lots of other questions. Are you able to switch over to the pad, Kyle?
Yep.
And so yeah, there's lots of questions under line 116. We're at the 20-minute mark, so I'm just conscious of time. Does anybody want to just pipe up with one last question or comment for Kyle before we move ahead in the agenda? Star 7 to unmute.
Hey Matt, it's Carla.
Hey Carla.
Hello.
Hey Kyle, I just want to thank you for presenting. This was tremendous. It's really wonderful to see the work that you've done, and obviously everybody loves the design of it, so really congratulations on that. And you're making a huge splash on Twitter, by the way. People are going crazy. So I'm wondering if you can actually share with us, do you anticipate that other universities will be able to scaffold off the work that you're doing, or are you planning on creating a consortium of any sort since you're kind of out there first in the field?
Excellent question. And the answer is we're open to a lot of different things, and part of this was, it's a struggle that we have, is, you know, so we've already had a number of institutions kind of engage us on this and begin to talk about, okay, how can we begin to scale this out? The bottom line is it's too early to say definitively how it works. We've done it every which way. So we have consortiums. So we have something called the Hub Zero Consortium. We've done other types of models. We've done licensing models. We've done startup models. We've done kind of shared effort models. So a lot of it depends on what kinds of partnerships we can get out of it. So if we have a collection of universities that really have an interest in kind of building out, a partnership where we can kind of exchange and trade ideas, then we're certainly interested in those kinds of discussions. So that's really like I said, it's kind of our challenge as an institution in terms of, you know, what is the best mechanism to move that forward.
Sorry, I was muted. Kyle, I was just thanking you for an awesome demo. Lots of other questions for you under line 116, so hopefully you can stick around and keep chatting with folks.
Absolutely. I have about 10 minutes, and so yeah. And like I said, if you, I think my Twitter handle is on there, so please reach out if you'd like to talk more, or anybody wants to talk more in depth about any particular point. I'm more than happy to chat further.
Great. Thanks, Kyle.
Thank you.
So let's push ahead to line 150. Mark and Aaron are going to take us through some WebMaker product definition. I'll pull up those slides. Aaron and Mark.
Hello, it is Mark. So if we get those slides up, I can
start chatting through them. But I guess just as context, and let me get the Etherpad back up so I see who's in the chat. So a number of people have been working on a refined definition of what is Mozilla Webmaker, and in particular, how do all of the pieces that we're building, popcorn, symbol, the content, the badges, fit together into a cohesive offering. And many of the people on this call have certainly heard that rap before in terms of our goal. It's the goal we set out as a kind of primary target for this year. But a bunch of people, including Aaron, who will take you through this, have been working on getting more concrete. What is really inside of that offering? Who is the audience for it? How do the pieces connect into each other? And we had a number of the Webmaker and Mozilla Foundation staff together here in Toronto last week, and we had a chance to further refine that. So I wanted to just show some of that work here so we start to get some community feedback. Aaron and I will also do some blog postings and feed this into the Webmaker news group for discussion. But really, this is a chance for people to kind of feedback on this, especially if there's anybody on the call who hasn't seen it before who has reactions, because this is sort of iteration two and something that I think we'll keep refining, and that also will pretty much do, you know, be a major input to how we plan next year. So just to, Matt, if you, because you've got the keyboard, want to go through the slides, you know, the first piece really is to see Webmaker as a product that is a part of Mozilla's overall effort to drive its mission. And you know, this kind of slide of Firefox for desktop, Firefox for mobile, and Webmaker for web literacy is a slide that I think you'll start seeing increasingly from people like Mitchell, even people like Gary, saying these are the three big bets that Mozilla is making. But as a big bet, it means that people need to be able to understand Webmaker as simply as they understand Firefox or Firefox OS. And also, we need to look at how all the different pieces or feature or content or community inside of it make sense to somebody. And that's not just a branding exercise, that's a product design exercise and a community development exercise. So go to the next one. And you know, one piece of that, which I think we're, especially after some feedback from my wife, not there yet, on is we need to be able to have an elevator pitch or a tweet that describes what this one thing is. If I were to say, you know, Firefox is the, you know, the browser that stands up for you, or the browser that protects your privacy, or the open source independent browser, you'd know what I was talking about. I think we have to get to that spot with Webmaker. We're not yet, but I think we actually made some progress last week. And so the tweet we came up with is Mozilla Webmaker is a quick way to make, remix, tweak, or tweak a web page or video while learning how the web works. And you know, I think there's a lot to be figured out in the tweak a web page or a video, because I think we really mean tweak anything on the web, although as soon as you say anything on the web, it means nothing. But I think people need to have in their mind that this is a tool you can make something with first, or a collection of a suite of tools to make something with first. And baked in is the idea you can also learn how it works. So I think we're a lot closer with that, and it's certainly what we need to get to. So Matt has changed it so I can no longer see the slides, but I think that is the end of me talking. So Aaron is playing a role really as the lead for product management, along with Chris McAvoy and Ryan, in figuring out what actually we build inside of this Webmaker concept. And so we did some refining on that this week. I'm going to let Aaron take us through those parts of the slide.
All right, great. So I just want to echo before diving in what Mark just said about that Webmaker is more than just a branding exercise, but we're really looking at it as a product. And so it's really important to sort of have that clear definition to be able to say what's in and out, to talk to what the target audience is, and really design from there. So Matt, next slide. The next few slides will basically give you kind of our high level. It's a little bit longer than an elevator pitch, but in a few slides kind of where we've gotten to with the scoping. So the first one is, that essentially Webmaker is a set of tools and projects that help people quickly make things that worth sharing on the web, and that piece is really important. So it's something that that they feel is worth sharing, that they're potentially proud of, that it's something that they care about, and that they want to show other people either in their social networks or what have you on the web. So it does really kind of empower the sort of end user, but it's also sort of setting a bar for ourselves about really letting them make real things. And then they also are learning webmaking skills in the process. So we have a philosophy of learning by making, and so we want to lead with the making where people dive right in and are, again, making things that they care about or worth sharing on the web, but that there is also the scaffolding there for them to learn skills along the way in the process. Next slide. And then so the tools, so again, Webmaker is a set of tools and projects. The tools that Webmaker currently includes are X-ray goggles, Symbol, and Popcorn. So most of you on this call have seen all of these, but in various forms. But this is kind of our current arsenal, if you will, of these tools. X-ray goggles is really focused at kind of seeing the bones of web pages and remixing web pages. Symbol is actually immersing you in the HTML and CSS itself in a 2-pane editor, and Popcorn allows you to augment video with a bunch of awesome information sort of tied to the content of that video. But so in addition to the tools itself, a really, really important piece of it are these starter projects that sit on top of the tools. And so those really, again, let people dive in and start to make things that they care about with these tools behind them. So they're making compelling web pages, they're making compelling videos, and ultimately, as Mark said, they're making anything. But we are trying to like get a little bit more concrete with these as well. So that's why we're saying like web pages and videos at this point. Next slide. Now, this is probably the most important slide, but we could build all of the tools and projects, possible. We could spend all of our time doing this, and we would never achieve what we're trying to achieve with Webmaker, which is really about making a generation of webmakers sort of at web scale. So if Mozilla is at the middle of this for much longer, we will not have succeeded. So really the life and blood of Webmaker is through a global community, and that global community includes people that are contributing projects, that are contributing even their own tools or learning pathways, are hosting events around building more webmakers, and are actually teaching webmakers. So it's really about this kind of this community, this movement, this group of people that are doing this with us, that are taking kind of some of the stuff that we're kicking off and extending it way beyond ourselves, and again helping to reach web scale. Next slide. and so that we've really honed in on our core or target audience, because we started this with we want to build something that's relevant to everybody, because we want everybody to be a web maker. We don't want it just to be future web developers. We don't want it to just be youth. We want it to be everybody, and that's amazing and awesome. And I think we still kind of believe that a little bit in our gut or in our hearts, but we know that again as we switch to focus on this as a product, we really need to define like what is the target audience, who are the people that we really are going to be designing for and speaking to every day. And we last week really kind of started to hone in on these two groups. One is the web makers themselves, which are anybody that's really interested in tinkering or expressing themselves and making stuff on the web. So while that still feels a little vague, we've got some words in here that are pretty important, like tinkering. So it's not necessarily about somebody coming in that I just want to make a professional website and that is all. While again, the tools may support that, ultimately, again, our target audience are people that are a little bit more playful, that are making things that they care about personally, that are about personal expression to share on the web. So that's, and I think we said in one way, it's like the people that eventually are going to be like the Tumblrs and making stuff again to share online. So that's really the webmaker piece of it. And then there's the webmaker makers, which are essentially these instructors or facilitators, teachers, although not just formal teachers, that are really this community of people out there that are interested in helping make future webmakers. So those are the two core audiences. The next slide. And then finally, all of this that we're talking about, the community, the tools, the projects, that will all come together at webmaker.org. And so we again, don't feel that webmaker.org isn't going to be the only place. I mean, ultimately, there will be, they'll push you out to other sites and other experiences as well. But the sort of central hub, the access point, will be through webmaker.org. So there's a lot of work that we're doing from a product level, specifically on webmaker.org, to sort of tie all of these pieces together. Next slide. So there's just a few characteristics, kind of a guiding design principles, if you will, that are going into our thinking right now. So one is just that Webmaker is a product, is a complete product offering. So Mark showed you the first slide. Like, we want this to be kind of at the level of Firefox. We want to think about this as a product and really think about an experience, a Webmaker experience, versus how we had been really thinking a lot before, which was, you know, sort of a thimble experience, a popcorn experience, et cetera. We want to sort of pull all of this together and present it as a product. That leads into number two, which is really about having this cohesive experience. And we really want that experience to help people level up from just kind of lurking or using to actually starting to contribute back. So creating projects, deciding that going from learner to a teacher, really kind of making that easy for people and sort of seamless for people. Strong element of peer and community participation. I think I've said over and over again how important the community is, so this is no surprise. But it's a slightly different perspective where it's not just about building a community around the stuff that we're making, but it's also about building community and peer into the experience so that you can find peers, you can do things together, you can find mentors, that kind of thing. Scaling as a core feature, so not just as a afterthought. It's not like build it and then scale it. Like, we want to be thinking about scale from the beginning. So how do we actually build that in from the beginning? And some of those ways I've already mentioned, but like making it really easy for other people to contribute starter projects, making it really easy for people to pick up what we're producing and remix it and use it themselves. But those need to be core features from the beginning. And then finally, agile and flexible development and growth. So we are doing a lot of thinking about sort of how we operate as a development team now that we're kind of thinking about this like Webmaker development team, and you know, trying to figure out and quickly how we are very flexible and iterative, but and kind of grown up about what we're doing, but also really able to be innovative and quick and fast. And that also plays into, again, how we bring other people into Webmaker, into the development processes, into the community. So those are the kind of main characteristics. Going to the next slide. Then we just have a few slides that kind of help take this and get and make it a little bit more real. So like what? So that's the last two slides have been kind of like our vision and our slightly longer elevator pitch. But now what does that mean in terms of what we're actually building? And so we have two slides left. One that I'm going to tell now is kind of how we see the product going in an arc over the next 6 months. And then Mark's going to tell you exactly what we're building for Mozfest to keep kind of getting even more concrete. But so the way that we're kind of seeing it for the next 6 months is we've already really done a lot of the making and learning foundation. So we launched the branding, we launched Thimble and a bunch of starter projects. We're launching Popcorn Maker soon. So we've done a bunch of stuff that really have laid that foundation and gotten a lot of great feedback and a lot of interest already, but we know that there's obviously a lot to do on top of that. So we spent all – so this says next week. Well, we spent all of last week, and we're going to continue to do this over the next few weeks, really kind of taking that foundation and deciding like where are we going with it next, and what are the end goals, at least in the near future. But then, kind of how we see it rolling out, Mozfest and beyond, is the next kind of set of focus that, or the next set of features that we're really doing are really about pulling together that that common design and experience across all of the tools. And so again, X-ray goggles, Thimble, and Popcorn, like how do we make one Webmaker experience that that really is seamless across all of these? So that's kind of a core focus with Mozfest, and part of that is badges. So that's another big feature that we're rolling out with Mozfest, and the badges will be something that become that kind of unifying goal for our learners and users, and that they're trying to learn things, they're trying to earn badges, they're trying to make things, and it's agnostic to what tool they need to do to get that. After ModFest, where we will be able to play test a bunch of this, obviously we'll be iterating on that, but we're also going to get real. We're going to get real about contribution. So we're doing a bunch of thinking right now. We're doing a bunch of talking. We're doing a bunch of planning. But we know we need to shift gears in a major way to start building the Contribution Foundation's core into our tools. And so that's things like localization, content creation, those kinds of things. And then early next year, we really want to make sure that we're shifting gears to really build out all of the features that help us kind of like build up the user and the social aspects of that experience. So user profiles, allowing people to set goals and build portfolios, allowing people to find peers within the tools. So all of that kind of user and social features that are really, really important to kind of make people feel part of a community, make people feel invested, and then some. So that's the arc for the next 6 months. And then, Mark, do you want to tell people what we will be building by ModFest?
I do.
So I guess I just wanted to come back in at the end, and thank you, Aaron, for giving us that big picture, to point people to this snapshot of what we're building by ModFest, which, you know, for most people on the call, none of these individual things will be surprising, or certainly, you know, everybody on this call is involved in some element of this in some way. What
I think was nice about this list, and it's interesting, I showed it to somebody who hadn't seen it at all before today. What's nice about this list is it shows how most, if not all, of the things we're doing, even if in a small way, plug into building this bigger Webmaker effort. And so, you know, it's not that the core Webmaker product is something that, the news fellows, for example, are going to wake up every day and think is the only thing that's on their plate. But there is a contribution that they're making into this. And, to some degree, it's starting to prototype how more sophisticated and more advanced people might feed into this and how we might start to do stuff for more mid-range, mid-skill people, like, say, journalists. So, I'm not going to go through one by one on this list, but I think, hopefully at every step of the way, we've got a list like this where we can see how all of those bigger priorities that Aaron is talking about, all those bigger things we're trying to build, Aaron's talking about, everybody has a way to plug into those, even if they're doing something that is, on the edges or bigger or slightly separate. So I think that was what was quite impressive about this list coming together out of the group that met last week. So I would, and I haven't been following the Etherpad, throw this open to questions from anybody, but especially people who haven't seen this before, or suggestions.
So there's a question around what the sort of next steps for publishing and sharing this are. It sounds like you and Aaron are going to write a post. Should we hold off on sharing these slides until you guys publish them as a blog post? Or?
Yeah, and I wouldn't mind. I think there's three next steps, in my opinion. One is anybody who's got feedback on these, to get them to Aaron or get them to Aaron and I. And I think Aaron and I will probably, with Chris and Ryan, do a kind of just a cleanup of these. I've already done a little bit of a cleanup of some of them to go into our board slides for tomorrow. So I think that next step is just clean them up. So I wouldn't share them now, not because there's anything wrong in them, but just because I think they'll be better in a few days, or certainly by the beginning of next week. The next step after that, which I don't know if we have an agenda on item on this, but Ryan might speak to if we don't, is to get some of the road mapping work, which again, the same group of people who were together last week worked on, to get some of that done and to get a kind of consolidated Mozilla Foundation and Webmaker roadmap up in a straw man on the interweb. That'll relate to this in a much higher level of detail. And there's a bunch of people on the call who probably haven't seen that, so getting that out in the community and floating around will be important.
And then the third thing is we will, Aaron and I are committed to by early next week having blog postings on this, and there probably is a roadmap blog posting as well. So I would certainly, given none of this is secret, and if you have a Summer Code Party compatriot who desperately wants to see these, then we're happy to share them. But it would be good for us to use this as a chance to give each other feedback and hone these a little bit.
Cool. So a couple other questions underline 180. Aaron says it's really important to be able to know what's in and what's out. What is out? Is there anything that we have consciously taken out of the product for focus or scope?
Well, so I think work on, or no, a lot of the work on the audience has really kind of provided us with a framework to really be able to scope things. So things like
Hey, Aaron, we've lost you. Aaron, are you there? Mark, do you want to pick up where Aaron left off?
I didn't hear enough of Aaron to know where she left off, but the question was, what are we adding, what are we taking away?
What are we taking out?
Aaron's going to type and I'll read, but I'll actually talk as well. So I think that the main thing is the audience focus that we got really does help us at least prioritize the order of things. And so one thing is, I think we've taken away the idea of stuff which is purely in the abstract for learning and focusing on content in particular, which I think will change a lot in the next 6 months, that provides a starting place for people who actually want to make something that they would share. So that is focusing in terms of what kinds of content projects and to a certain degree what kind of features are in scope. And then the other thing, which we certainly added, but by implication it takes a bunch away, at least in the short term, is the idea of teachers as our primary secondary audience. I don't know if I can say that. But the idea that teachers broadly cast, people who want to help make web makers, want to light a spark of creativity in others, want to show off what the web can do, that's the core group we're going to go to first to help scale this and help feedback on it and hopefully help them do what they want to do in the world, means that a lot of other contributor types, of which we've, we listed about 10 here, move immediately into second, second prioritization is not where we're going to put our immediate resources. Doesn't mean that people won't keep showing up to contribute to popcorn or other things, but certainly those things are off the table in terms of where we'll put our big push. And I think the only thing that stays on the table as another big contributor push is localizers. So I think those are two things that go off the table. And I think the other thing is, we made what I hope is a realistic assessment, only the road mapping will tell, of pushing certain things like social and the gallery into early next year, despite the fact that we think those are really important things to have. So we're pushing things along the timeline as we roadmap.
Cool. So there's lots of other questions and chat happening in the pad. Does anybody want to speak up with a high-level question or comment?
I think that pad is awesome. Here's what we go and double down on in the writing, and just generally probably something that we should save a screen capture of for posterity.
any last thoughts before we push ahead?
Do we want to have Ryan say a little bit about the road mapping, or do we have that in agenda?
Is Ryan on the call? We spoke his name and he magically appeared. Ryan, do you want to talk a little bit about road mapping?
Sure. I was sitting in the overflow room next door. The road mapping was the result of all the different teams trying to map out not just what they're working on over the next 15 months, but also where the interdependencies are. So you can't do thing A until thing B arrives, and if person X thinks they're not building thing B until much, much later, that creates problems. So the problem or the challenge was to try and map all those interdependencies so that everything lands in the right order and things get shipped on time. That became a very, very large and somewhat unwieldy wall full of sticky notes, which I'm now in the process of turning into something wieldy, a thing that we can look at, understand, and know what we're working on right now and into the future. My intention is to be in a position to share that later this week internally, and then it would be great if we could be sharing it externally, maybe on next week's call. I think that's probably appropriate, depending on how it goes. It might cost us a week, but I'd rather be back here next week on it.
Great. Any questions on roadmapping or product definition stuff before we push ahead? Cool. So we have 10 minutes left. We knew that today was going to be pretty full. So I wonder if we can do just like kind of quick hit on the Webmaker Global UX UI stuff. Jess and Chris, can you just give us a quick summary version?
Sure. Basically, as we are evolving the Webmaker product offering, we're also evolving our process for working on various Webmaker products as a design team. And so we wanted to just tell you on a high level how you can work with us. So on line 212 to 218 are our channels to interact with us, including our IRC channel, and asking for people to feedback on our various design thinking. And also just to say that we're going to actively use this community call to do peer assist, asking for feedback and outright critique. And to kick that off, I'm going to pass the baton to Chris to run our quick peer assist. That's enough for you?
Awesome.
Cool. Well, on line 221 there, we started to collect a list of user flows that will start to sort of define what the product offering actually is. So for anyone who doesn't know, user flows are basically just the steps a user would take to achieve a goal, and a goal would basically be how can we help users do the things that they want to do, so why are they actually coming to Webmaker, and how do they want to use the product. So a lot of this has come from the conversations from last week, from things that we were talking about with road mapping and stuff like that. Trying to boil it down to like a set of questions or flows that people actually start to think about how can I actually do this kind of thing. So divided them up based on the different audiences. So at this line 14 there, we have a list of questions that webmakers would ask, divided into areas like projects, badges, tools, community, events. And then we've also, on line 59, had a list of what instructors might ask, so things about teaching, badges, resources, and community. So it would be great if you guys could all have a look at this list, and after hearing the presentation from Mark and Aaron, everyone probably has an idea of how this thing should actually shape up. So if you see things that aren't captured, or you thought, hey, I thought we were going to do this, to define the different areas, you can say, you can add to the Etherpad there, and we'll take it from there. It's a work in progress. It's rough, so feel free to add any ideas you have there.
Great. People are in there hacking on your Etherpad right now.
Cool.
Awesome. Building a Summer Code Party Hall of Fame. So there's some notes underlined 233. Rebecca, just really quickly, is there something in particular that you're looking for folks to help with on building a Hall of Fame?
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yep.
All right. So this is the Prototype Hall of Fame. One really important thing about it that everyone should know is that this doesn't necessarily represent the very, very best things that happened all summer. This is the stuff that we happened to see when we were looking. I know that you guys all have some really cool stuff, things that you're aware of, awesome people. We'd really like to hear about that. So please, please, please submit your stuff, and we will make this Hall of Fame even better. Thank you.
Cool. Yeah. So just to underline, you'll notice that Rebecca has a big, huge, honking like submit link on that page, and that's really designed to do what she just described, which is get your ideas, your nominees for people who really rocked this summer, an instructor or a teacher who really inspired you, an amazing thing you saw somebody make with popcorn. We know that you all kind of have that stuff in your heads, and we want to try and capture it on this page. Cool. So, Sayak, you've been waiting very patiently. What can you tell us about Moz Carnival?
Hey,
Star 7, unmute.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, so last weekend we had our event, Moz Carnival, and we had invited reps and webmakers from all over India, all Mozilla volunteers. So we had over 14 reps and Mozilla volunteers present at the event, most notably Gautam Raj, Vinil, Komal, Komal who is the first female rep from India. She has a 600-plus fan following on FB. And plus we had a huge crowd turn-up. We had around 90-plus students from all over Pune and 82 walk-in registrations. So what exactly happened at the event was the event was mostly centered around the huge success that we had throughout India about Moz Party. And then again, the celebrations of the Software Freedom Day. I myself started with the keynote, followed by Ankit, who talked about FOSS and Mozilla. Then again, Vinil talked about the Firefox Fix, where we had a quiz and we distributed lots of goodies. Then again, there were the discussions on URLs and LTMN and contributing to Mozilla. The very special mention goes to Priyanka and Hema, who took a session on WOMOS, that is Women and Mozilla. And then again, we had the hands-on sessions. Gautam Raj did an excellent job at the hands-on. He made people make a lot of stuff. He made some cool web pages using Thimble. Then again, it was up to Anvesh, who explained about the about config features of Firefox. I myself had a hands-on session on open badges, wherein I made the audience create their own badges and add them to their backpack. I also did a small presentation on banana bread so that people, because people, especially the students, they are very interested in games and try to showcase the power of Mozilla Firefox. We had quiz, we had a very special birds of a feather round wherein we had a very interesting discussion with all the FOSS groups from all around Pune about how all the FOSS communities can actually work in collaboration with each other. There were some suggestions about maybe using open badges for maybe some kind of course curriculum wherein some communities who were interested in teaching stuff could actually use badges to which can be rewarded to people who learn things. Then again, at the end of the event, we had a huge party. We had got a large chocolate cake and stuff. then again, there are the links, the Mozilla Pune website, which we actually launched last week. It still needs a bit of tweaking. And the event pages, the Google Plus links, the Facebook links. We have shared the slides, the ones that I could get my hands on right now. And then again, the Facebook album pages. We still haven't got access to all the pictures that we had clicked on the event day. So there are around 1,000-plus pictures, and it's we haven't yet been able to sort them all. Then again, the video stream can be found on Google+, and one of the blogs links I've added over here. So that's about it. So for questions.
Fantastic. Thanks, Zach. Who's got questions for Sayak? Oh, sorry, there's some on the Etherpad. Let me pull those up.
Yeah, actually, we had so we had a lot of new attendees who came in for webmaking. We had a lot of undergraduate students, some students from nearby schools who came in to learn about webmaking, who were completely newbies, and they found it great, especially Gautam Raj's session. It was great. plus events. We are planning on doing a small event for the end of some MOS party. The main event, the main reason why we did such a huge scale event was this was like the closure party for MOS, closure event for MOS party at Pune, because next week it's actually the final weekend when everyone will be celebrating and organizing their own closure events for MOS party throughout India. But we wanted all the awesome webmakers from all around India to be able to attend the event and also conduct their own events. And we went for 1 week before the final closure. Also, we will be having some smaller events. Okay.
So, Sayak, we're at the end of the hour, and some folks need to drop off. So maybe we'll just pause, and those who need to jump can, and others who want to stay and chat are welcome to stay and chat as well. There's a suggestion in line 349 that seems really kind of exciting. I'm not sure if that's Brett or Emma mentioning that at the Moz party they had in Victoria, Canada last week, the participants really liked hearing about your event and knowing that people in another part of the world were engaged in web making kind of the same way they were. So that the question for you was, do you think it would be interesting, well, A, are you going to hold future events? And B, do you think it'd be interesting to have each event kind of say hello to another web making event in a different part of the world?
Yeah, actually, it's a great opportunity. Plus, it also provides a sense of community to all the attendees. Personally speaking, when we showed the video that Michelle had sent of all the web makers from Mozilla saying hello to everyone in Pune, everyone was very, very excited. They were like, okay, it's a short clip, but it's had a large impact. Plus, when we did the clip about saying hello to the Victoria event, the reps were very, very interested. Plus, we were thinking of making some more videos, but due to some time constraints, we couldn't do it. But it's actually a great idea. We should actually continue such things because we have like a minimum of 4 or 5 events happening each weekend. That is simultaneously in different parts of the world. So collaboration is one thing that should be fostered, and saying hello is a great way of doing that. We can even go one step further and maybe have some kind of an online discussion, maybe a Google Plus Hangouts or something can be done. So that's the big idea behind it.
I mean, I think the other question for you, Sayak, is like there's a lot of people who are really interested in duplicating your success, like basically doing their own version of what you all did together at Moz Carnival. So I know you have a lot of links in the pad, but is there any way that you think you could help document that further and kind of create a how-to for other people who basically want to do a version of what you guys just did?
We are actually planning on these things. So what we are currently doing is we are collecting all the articles, all feedback and links from everyone who were there at the event, and also collecting feedback from everyone. So based on that, we can put a blog post, which can be, I guess, helpful for anyone who wants to hold similar events. The main idea behind this is to take the initiative, and people who are enthusiastic enough can actually build or host such great events. So we'll be having numerous blog posts coming up by the end of this week. And plus, we also had media coverage during the event. We had one of the leading dailies in India midday covering the event. So we will also be having maybe 450 words or something in news coverage sometime around next week. So these things, we'll be sharing these things, how these things can be arranged, and we'll also be sharing the slides. So I think by next week or the end of next week, we should be able to do all that. But we have a lot of stuff, so it will take a bit of time for us to create such blog posts.
Great. Well, when that documentation further along, we'd love to have you come back and share it with us.
Okay.
A lot of interest.
I'll be sending you an email to the mailing list.
Great.
For that.
Thanks, Sayak.
Thanks, everyone.
So I apologize to Victoria Popcorn Moz Party. Well, Brett, you've listed that as a potentially nonverbal item, so we can have folks just read and scan there. I've just lost access to the Etherpad. But I think that was it for the agenda. There's lots of nonverbal items on the pad lower down, if we can get the pad to work again. Any final thoughts, shout-outs, or quick peer assist before we wrap up? The Etherpad timing is impeccable. The Ether gods are reminding us to wrap things up. So thanks for an action-packed, great call, everybody. Talk to you all next week.
Yay!
Bye.
Thank you. Please stand by.